is going to be bringing us our message today, and so I told him I would step in to the liturgist position so he didn't have to do everything this morning. So thank you, Keith, for doing that, and we look very much forward to your message today. Start with some announcements. For the younger members of the church, Kim Case is sending out information for summer camp at Westminster Woods. There are also brochures on the table in the Northex. The deadline to sign up is April 2nd. And if you're planning to attend, please get signed up soon online and then print off copies of all your forms, get them to the office. Our policy is we pay 100% for church members and children. And then if they have a friend that would like to attend with them, we will pay 50% of that cost. So that's a wonderful gift that our church gives to our children. I know that church camp was a big, big part of fostering my personal faith. So I hope people take advantage of that. It will be our turn to serve the cup meal on Thursday, March 16th. It's early, but there is a sign-up sheet hanging in the Narthex for volunteers. Vanessa tells us that they're feeding around 150 or more each Thursday, so she's hoping to get at least 13 lasagnas, 25 dozen cookies, and of course, helpers are always needed. Also, a reminder that Wednesday, March 1st, we're going to try something new. I think that's always good to try something new. And we're going to be holding all church committee meetings at the same time. We're going to begin at 5:15. Down in Gaiman Hall. This was something that was suggested by, his name just left my head, but he is the minister that comes down and helps our session. What's his name?
Reverend Wiley.
Reverend Wiley, thank you. This is something he does in his church very successfully. It allows people to communicate between committees when that's necessary. So we're going to try it. A lot of people are like, well, what do I do if I'm on more than one committee? We'll figure it out somehow. But it will bring us all together so that we can do our committee work at the same time and join in prayer at the same time. So please don't forget that that is Wednesday at 5:15, and we hope to see you there for our committee work. Then next Sunday, we are going to be meeting our new interim pastor, Reverend Charles Freeman. Reverend Freeman and his wife will be coming to join us from Gainesville, Florida, so we hope everybody will be able to be in attendance. There is some information in your bulletin about Reverend Freeman for you to read, and after worship next Sunday, we'll all convene in Gaiman Hall for a potluck dinner. She says, I have it on good authority that Reverend Freeman is a Southern boy who likes his fried chicken. We can't wait to taste all the good Presbyterian food being planned by our great cooks. Please call the church office and let Alberta know what you are planning to bring. She's making a list. Does anybody else have any announcements for this morning? If there are none, will you please join me in our call to worship? It is a responsive reading found in your bulletin. We have entered into the season of Lent. Sundays, however, are not a part of Lent.
We have entered the wilderness time, yet this day of worship is in our faces in the desert.
People of God, on this wilderness journey, what will you eat?
The word of the Lord is our daily bread.
People of God, in this time of temptation, how will you live?
Our faith is in the faithfulness of God.
People of God, at this kingdom crossroad, who will you serve? We worship the Lord our God alone. That was in mine, sorry. We worship the Lord our God alone, everybody. We worship the Lord our God alone. Okay, so would you please join me for our first song, To God Be the Glory. It is number 63 from the Red Hymnal. And please stand in your room. No, it's not 63. Say that again. Boy, flexibility is awesome. Yes.
Three,
they left the four off the white paper. I'm going to go to the brown paper that you have. It is, oh, it says 63. 634. Right? Okay, and please stand if you're ready. Happy are those whose sin is forgiven. Be glad in the Lord and shout for joy. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Let us sing glory to God. In preparing for today's message, Keith and I communicated a little bit, and I shared with him what the scriptures were for our lectionary, and he chose to use two of those scriptures rather than the ones that are in your bulletin. So it's just a theme for today that we're not doing anything the way it's printed in the bulletin. That's good. So our first scripture is from Genesis. On our regular Bible, it's on page 2. In the large print Bible, it's on page 3. I'll be reading from Genesis 2, verses 15 through 17, and from Genesis 3, verses 1 through 7. Genesis 2, verse 15. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work at it and care for it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die." And then from chapter 3, beginning at verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman. "For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. This is the word the Lord has given to God.
Thank you.
from Romans. It is found on page 798 in our Pew Bible, or 1607 in the large print Bible. That's 798 or 1607. I'll be reading from Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 19. Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 19. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all people, because all sinned. To be sure, sin was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not charged against anyone's account where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even over those who did not sin by breaking a command, as did Adam, who is a pattern of the one to come. But the gift is not like the trespass. For if the many died by the trespass of one man, how much more did God's grace and the gift that came by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many? Nor can the gift of God be compared with the result of one man's sin. The judgment followed one sin and brought condemnation, but the gift followed many trespasses and brought justification. For if by the trespass of the one man death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of the one man the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man the many will be made righteous. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've been told to speak loudly. Can you hear me in the back? Good. I'm grateful to be here this morning. I'd like to share with you what God has done in my life. I found myself in a desperate situation, unable to stand before God because of sin. And God blessed us all through Jesus Christ, that by faith, we are justified before God. I'm a citizen of the United States of America. Because I'm a citizen, the actions of my predecessors and those that are representative leaders of the country impact my life. I have fellowship with God because of the obedience of Jesus Christ and my faith in Jesus Christ. And now I'm enjoying the benefits of being part of God's family because God has a plan. I wasn't born into God's family. I was born into the family of Adam. And Adam was the man that God created, as we read earlier. And being born into the family of Adam, the actions of my predecessor Adam, in this case, disobedience, and my own actions had an impact on me before Christ, faith in Christ. That was part of my life. because of this family that I was born into and my predecessor Adam's actions, I was impacted by sin. And then my own sinful nature, I sinned and was impacted by sin. But praise be to God that through Jesus Christ, we have freedom from sin and death. And we are called to be members of the family of God. We are children of God, beloved and cherished. See, I had inherited the cravings of the sinful nature, which is Ephesians 2:3. And from Adam, imputed sin, which is Romans 5:12. And my sin prevented me from the fellowship with him that God intended. That's Romans 3:23. But God's plan for me and for each of us is a restored fellowship that Adam once enjoyed. If we talk about the verse from Genesis, who did God give the command to? Don't eat of that tree. Who did he say that to? He said that to Adam. And then the serpent lied. It was a lie of omission. It was a partial truth. You're not going to instantly die, is what the lie was. But he didn't say that part. He just said, you're not going to die, which was a lie. What is a worse fate than separation from the fellowship of God? In the garden, each day, walking and talking with God, complete, pure fellowship with God. And because of Adam's disobedience, we couldn't have that. But praise be to God that through his gift, his son, Jesus Christ, we can accept Christ, have faith in Christ, and have fellowship with God once again. Here on earth in his church, in his kingdom, and in heaven, as is expressed in the book of Revelation, we'll be with God at this banquet table with God and Jesus and all the saints that have accepted Christ, and the rivers and the banquet and the tree of life. The tree of life was in the garden, and it is in the banquet at the end, which is the new beginning, not the end. So the serpent was talking to Eve. Where was Adam? It says he was standing right there with her. He was with her. Did Eve hear the command? Only secondhand from Adam. So, you know, the part of me wonders about this failing. We know it was a failing of Adam to not step up and say something. And then I just can't imagine what he was thinking. But he did fail, and they failed together. And because of this, we have a new plan from God, a plan of reconciliation. He talks about it in that very moment. He gives the curse. The ground is cursed. The people are cursed. And because of this, there's a hard life, a disconnected life, instead of perfect life that God planned for them and for us. I am active in sharing my faith through a method called Discovery Bible Study. I am not the inventor of this, I'm just one of the people that do this. The basis of this is the Word of God. And in Isaiah chapter 55, verses 10 and 11, it says, "As the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth, and it will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it." So it is this belief in the power of God's word that drives this study. It's a very simple study. It is not a study that tells people what they have to believe and tells people what they have to think. It's been my experience that that is repulsive to people. What it does, for instance, we would read Genesis chapter 2 and perhaps 3, and then we would ask in a discussion group, and everybody would talk about it. What does this story say about God? And then everyone would share their answer. And then, what does this story say about people? And everyone would share their answers. And then, what does this story say or mean to me? And everyone shares their answers. In the course of 11 weeks, we go through this study, and we read through the Bible, and we see God's plan. We see that God saved Noah and his family and destroyed the wicked masses. We see that very clearly in the story of Abraham and Isaac, Isaac is carrying the wood for the sacrifice. And they're going along, and Isaac asks his father, "Where's the lamb for the sacrifice?" And Abraham says to Isaac, "God will provide." And they go along, and still Isaac asks again, "Where's the sacrifice?" And they get to the point, and they build the fire, and Abraham, thinking that God can raise this boy if I have to sacrifice him, his only son that he has waited years for, many years, and he's about to sacrifice him. And the Lord stops him, and he provides a ram whose horns are tangled. He provides a sacrifice. He does this again in Egypt. The people are in Egypt, and they have the Passover, and each family slaughters a lamb or goat and puts the blood over the lintel of the door, and again, there's a sacrifice. This is pointing to Jesus again and again and again. And 700 years before Jesus, it is prophesied that he would suffer and that he would redeem us, and he did. And praise be to God that he did. The great thing about this study, there is no belief in God required. Last year, there were four people in a study, not at the same time, but in different studies. And there were others, but there were four of these people that had no history with God. Didn't know about God, didn't know about Jesus, just nothing. And they at least found out about God. They at least found out about God's plan. They at least found out what Jesus has done for them if they accept him. And I hope that God provides more people. participate in another study soon. The verse in the New Testament says, some water, some plant, I'm getting it out of order, some harvest. And I don't know where all of that is for these people who had never heard about Jesus, but one came to believe. And that's good news. That's one person that God saved from the desperate condition that they were in, without hope, without peace, without love. And now they have fellowship with God and peace. And so I ask us to think about who we might know that could participate in a study like this. I found that just asking is the best way to get someone to participate. The gentleman who came to faith in Christ, I didn't think he would say yes to even come to the study, but he did. And so I would like us to think about that. And if anybody is interested in that sort of thing, please talk to me after the service is over. My message today is that God has a plan, and that God's plan saved me, and it saved you as well, if you put your faith in Him. That is the lesson for today. The next hymn is 435. Let's all join in that hymn.
Please, our cards out in the narthex today. We have a sympathy card to Chuck and Marilyn Doe and their family on the recent passing of Chuck's father. We have a get well card for Alberta's husband, Harry Smith, who is recovering from pneumonia and as of yesterday is going to be released to go back home. So praise God for that. We also have a congratulations to our third grade teacher, Daryl Clifton, who was named Teacher of the Month for USD 446. Are there any joys or concerns to be shared with the congregation this morning? Yes, Val?
Turn for the words, Dorothy asked us to pray, and keep her in prayer. Also, I visited the
Bow says that she had talked to Dorothy Bailey, and her sister is Jonestown, is that what you said? Has taken a turn for the worse, and she covets our prayers at this time. Bow said she also talked with Michelle DeCioli, who also greatly appreciates being included in our prayers. Are there any other joys or concerns? Yes, you're good. Yes, Jurgen said the good news is that Val was standing up on her own 2 feet, and we're very thankful for that. I'm sure Val is as well. Are there any other joys or concerns to share? Yes. Just to repeat that, Linda is wanting us to remember those young people that are suffering through a lot of anxiety and issues. And there's currently a revival of Christ going on in that college age level group. There's a movie coming out called The Jesus Revelation that she says is very poignant for this time. And I echo that. You know, coming out of the pandemic, we are seeing a lot of anxiety in children at all levels. And people that we all went back to the norm, but for those that had never attended a college class in what we consider the norm, that's very different. For children that never attended a preschool or a kindergarten in what we know is the norm, it's bringing a lot of new things that are challenges to our world. So I think that's very appropriate for our prayers. Thank you for sharing that, Linda. Anything else? Please join me. Creator God, with all the faithful, let us pray to you. Who is our hiding place in times of trouble? Who surrounds us with glad cries of deliverance? We pray for all who are hungry, whether hungry for power and glory, or hungry for a simple meal, or hungry for your comforting touch. Show the mighty that you alone can satisfy their deepest need. Feed the poor from the abundance of your good creation. We pray for those who are in a time of trial or those who are in need due to sickness or injury. We pray for Anita, Savannah, Michelle, Rayanne, Dow and her family, Nikki and Rick, Joan, John and Judy. We ask that we are grateful for the healing steps that the fever has made from her recent surgery and pray that you continue that healing. Please wrap your loving arms around Charlotte Fitch and Melissa Hurley as they continue to battle cancer. We ask that you continue to watch over Lieutenant Colonel Timothy Kelly and his unit while they are in Kuwait, and to remember all the thousands of men and women of our armed forces who are stationed within the United States or around the world, and keep them safe. We ask that you continue to send your love to Evelyn, Art, Joan, Lucinda, and Harry Smith. We are grateful for the healing that Harry best way that he's able to come home, and pray that you will continue that healing. We ask that you continue to bless Savannah and heal her. We ask that you continue to bless our church members, Bill and Jackie Oaks, as well as the congregation of the First Presbyterian Church of Durban, Kansas. We ask that you continue to pray. We ask for continued prayers and support for the Presbyterian Disaster Assistance Program as it helps those in America and around the world. We pray for the college age and young age youth that have gone through many anxiety times as we look for a resurgence of the revelation of Christ, especially through the movie, The Jesus Revelation. We ask for a safe journey and high attendance next week as we welcome our new England pastor. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. As the ushers come forward, hear these words of prayer for our call to give gifts. As God so freely offers us the gift of life in Jesus Christ, let us respond with gratitude, offering our lives to God.
Thank you.
Serve God. Serve with praise and joy every day of the week. Know that it is not easy to keep our focus on God. Many distractions will vie for our attention. But may the steadfast love of God surround you throughout these 40 days and into the everlasting life, and be open each day to God's counsel and instruction. Learn from Christ to make difficult choices. God sends us out into the wilderness, and sometimes we realize that we are needed. And we know that the gift that God gives us brings us resurrection, brings us life everlasting. So please know that the oasis is here to refresh us. Go in peace and love.